So we should, well, I shall try to finish this morning. I hope I get to the end of what I wanted to say. So yesterday we had seen this example of this magnetic monopole bundle, where we have shown that the integral of the electromagnetic field strength, which is a two-form, integrated over some compact two-manifold, was actually quantized. So we found a 2 pi times an integer. Okay, so we could, of course, normalize things like this, and we'd find that that's an integer, which at first sight might seem surprising, because you would think that you can take any electromagnetic configuration. But, well, this measures the flux of the magnetic field, so it measures the magnetic charge, which was at the origin. And we found just by these topological considerations that it was quantized. Okay. Now, the reason was, that of course, that F is dA. And if A is globally defined on our sphere, which it was not, well, then by Stokes' theorem, this is just zero. Okay. So then if A is not globally defined, we have to look how we patch the A on the upper half sphere and on the upper half space, on the lower half space, how we patch them together. And this gave us some quantization condition, which resulted in this integer. So what I want to show now, quite generally, that we can generalize this and define what are called characteristic classes. So we call a characteristic class P a something which is locally defined on a manifold. So that's a local form on our manifold. And that is constructed from the curvature or the field strength. So it's P of F for gauge theory. And if later we deal with gravity, it will be some polynomial in the curvature two form. And which is such that the integrals of P over some, over the manifold or over some, whatever, two p-dimensional submanifold are sensitive only to non-trivial topology. Okay, so we'll see how this goes. So this again is due to the fact that P will be closed, just like DF was zero. DP is closed, but P is not D of some Q, at least not globally. Okay, locally this will be true. Okay, well, what we will do, we have our manifold, and we will cover it by several coordinate patches. So every coordinate patch has a trivial topology, diffeomorphic to some open set of R to the n. So on U1, U2, and so on. So on any UI, on any coordinate patch, we will have that P on I is D of some Q on I. That will be true. So locally on every patch, we will have that the integral of pi on ui is just the integral of qi over the boundary of this coordinate patch. Okay, so then we will sort of restrict our coordinate patches such that there are overlaps. So that's like U1, U2, U3, such that their overlaps are just submanifolds of one dimension less. Okay, so, and then, so every overlap appears twice. So this will appear as the boundary of U2, and it will appear as the boundary of U3. So then if we full we have to divide this into the sum over our coordinate patches, ui, p on I, and then we'll use this relation. We get the q's on the boundaries, but every boundary occurs twice. So what we'll find then is that this equals the sum over the intersection, how shall I call it, the intersection between u2 and u3 on the different boundaries. And we'll get Q on I for the boundary of UI minus Q on J. integral over the this u, well, this intersections uij. Okay, so this how we will see that the integral of p will be completely determined just in terms of the transition functions of this q between the I patch and the j patch, and that's how we show that it's sensitive only to these transition functions which are related to the non-trivial topology. Okay, so well, we'll be interested in constructing our P F will be the trace of F to the M, which is trace of F M times. Okay. This is a gauge invariant polynomial, because under a gauge transformation F goes to G F G minus 1. So all the G minus 1 G's in the middle will cancel. There's a G here, G minus 1, and by cyclicity we move it around and they cancel. So PM is gauge invariant. Okay, PM is gauge invariant. And the PMs are closed forms. That's easy to see. The gauge field strength F satisfies the Bianchi identity, and the Bianchi identity states that DF is F commutator with A, FA minus AF, or the other way around, depending how exactly you normalize things with these I's. So then if I take D of PM, well, my exterior derivative can act on any of these F's, so I get the df somewhere, but then I can move it around so that all these terms give me the same thing, trace df wedge f to the m minus 1. I use my Bianchi identity, so that's trace of fa minus af times f to the m minus 1. And then, well, in the first term, f is a 2 form, so I can move this 2 form. I can use again cyclicity to move the f to the end, and I will only change the order of an even form with an even form, so I don't get a minus sign, and I will get a f to the m minus a f to the m, so that vanishes. Okay, so this PM is a closed form, and to show that it that it's integral, so now we want to look at the integral of PM. So that's a 2 form, so we need to integrate this over some 2m dimensional compact manifold. So to show that this only depends on the transition functions of my gauge bundle, well, what I will do, I will take two gauge connections, A1 and A0, that have the same transition functions on overlaps between different patches, okay? So, okay, so that means A1 on patch I will be related to A1 on patch J, so there's some transition function, Gij, A1 on J plus D, Gij minus 1, so that's it on with some transition functions Gij, and the gauge connection A0 has the same transition functions, okay? Gij A0 on J plus D Gij minus 1, okay? Which in particular means that if I look at the difference A1 minus A0 on I, if I subtract them, this inhomogeneous term will drop out, and this transforms as A1 on J minus A0 on J, Gij minus 1. So it transforms covariantly as do transform my field strengths. Okay? Okay? So what I want to show is that my invariant polynomial PM constructed from the field strength associated with A1 minus the polynomial associated with the field strength constructed from A0, that this difference is exact. So it's D of something that now is globally defined on our manifold. Okay. Locally, of course, this was true for every, it was true for PM of F1. So locally on any coordinate patch, this is D of something. Okay. Locally, this on every coordinate patch is D of something. But the something is not globally well defined. What I want to show is that the difference is well defined, is a well defined 2m minus 1 form. Okay, that's a little computation. So, because if I have this, of course, then the integral of Pm of F1 minus the integral of Pm of F0 will be the integral of dr over my closed compact manifold, which will be 0. So we find that the integral of Pm of F1 is the same as the integral of Pm of F0. So which means that the integral of Pm of F does not change as long as I change my A, but I stay with the same transition functions. That's exactly what I want to show. Okay, so to show this, we'll interpolate between A0 and A1. So define some AT, which is A0, plus T times A1 minus A0. Okay? So T is some interpolating parameter between 0 and 1. So then for this AT, I can compute a corresponding FT as DAT plus AT squared. Okay? And I can check how this varies with t. I compute d by dt of this ft. Oops, no, that's too high up. Okay. So, well, you just compute, you take the derivative with respect to t, and you find that this is the dt covariant derivative of a1 minus a0. Okay. That's just a two-line computation. So now we can compute the... Now let me change my blackboard. So now we can compute the corresponding invariant polynomial for this FT. Right, we want to interpolate between the polynomial for F1 and F0, and that will be done with this FT. So my Pm of Ft, which is just the trace of Ft wedge Ft m times. Okay, so now I'm going to take d by dt of this. Okay, so I will get m times dft by dt wedge Ft blah 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 blah. Okay. Okay, so dFd by dt, I just computed it, so that's m times the trace of the dt covariant derivative of a1 minus a0, wedge ft. Okay, now ft satisfies the Bianchi identity with this t covariant derivative, so dt of ft is 0, which means that I can add all these terms where dtx on here, so I can pull it out from my trace. So that's m dt of the trace of a1 minus a0 wedge ft wedge blah 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 ft. Okay. Now comes the important thing. As I just showed you, now a1 has various transition functions between the patches and transforms with this non-homogeneous term, just like any gauge connection. Same is true for A0, but because they have the same transition functions, in the difference, the inhomogeneous term drops out. So we had that A1 minus A0 on patch I was Gij A1 on patch J minus A0 on patch J, Gij minus 1. Just as my field strength, right? The F, F0, F1, Ft, they all have the same transition functions. On patch I is Gij Ft on J, Gij minus 1. So they all transform the same Gs. So when I compute this trace, all the Gs drop out, the last one cycles around. So this is an object which has no transition function, okay? And if I look at gauge transformations again, this is an invariant object. So this covariant derivative is actually just an ordinary derivative, okay? This is the same as M, the ordinary exterior derivative acting on trace A1 minus A0, Ft wedge Ft. Okay? And because these transition functions drop out, this is something which is globally well-defined on my manifold. No transition functions between different patches. So, I'm going to integrate this now over this t parameter from 0 to 1, and I find that Pm of F1 minus Pm of F0 is the integral from 0 to 1 dt of this thing here. D of this thing, so this is d of the integral from 0 to 1 dt m trace a1 minus a0 wedge ft wedge blah 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 ft. Okay, so this is the exterior derivative of some globally well-defined 2 and minus 1 form, which I call R. And then if I integrate this over a closed 2m dimensional manifold, this will give 0, and we have shown that this integral equals that integral. Okay? So that's what we wanted to show. Well, we've not only shown this, we can actually use this result. I said that locally on every coordinate patch, I knew, of course, that P was D of something, okay, but not globally. But we can use this thing now to compute what is this 2m minus 1 form. So on every coordinate patch ui, we have that Pm on I is D of some q 2m, some 2m minus 1 form. Okay, on I, so that's locally defined. But we can use just this previous computation to determine what these Qs are. Because inside a given coordinate patch U, I, there's no question of transition functions, and I may just choose now A0 to be 0 and A1 to be A. Okay. Of course, now A0 and A1 have the same transition functions because there are no transition functions inside this patch. And I can then just use this formula. So if A0 is 0, my F0 is 0. So this term drops out. And I find that Pm of F equals D of something. So I know what the something is. So then we have that Pm of F on I is D of this. I just write again the same thing, okay, with this Q2m minus 1 on patch I being given by this formula with A0 equals 0 and the corresponding Ft. So this is now m integral from 0 to 1 dt trace A Ft to the m minus 1 where the FT now is the same FT as before, but with A0 being 0. So FT is it's T dA plus T square A squared. Okay. So we have a very explicit formula to compute these Q2Ms. We may, of course, factor out a T here. So we find that this Q2M minus 1 is M integral 0 to 1 dt, T to the M minus 1 trace of A times dA plus TA squared to the power M minus 1. Okay, so we just do the integrals over the t's and we find these different q2m minus 1's. That's okay locally on every coordinate patch. Okay, so these things are called the Chern-Simons forms. So we can compute them, and let me just examples. So M equals two. So then we have trace F squared equals D of Q3. So that's the Chern-Simons 3 form. Q3, well, it's easy. So just have a T here, just one integral to be done. So we find that Q3 is trace ADA plus 2/3 of A cube. Okay? So just let me remind you that these A's which I write here are related by this minus I to the old A. Yeah. Okay. So if you go back to the original A mu's, there are some I's appearing in this formula and some signs, but that you can easily figure out from by yourself. Okay? So if you want to check that D of Q3 is trace F squared, that's easy. DQ3, so the inside the trace. So here I only get the DADA, so that's the DADA. So here I get my D can act on any of these A's, okay? So I get a 2/3 dA A squared. Then, because this is an odd form, I get a minus 2/3 A dA A and plus 2/3 A squared dA. Now, because of cyclicity of the trace, I can take this 2 form dA and move it here. So I get another DAA, and this is a 3 form, that's a 1 form. So I can move the A here, but I get a minus sign, which changes the sign. So altogether, these 3 terms give me the same contribution. They give a plus 2 DA A squared, okay? Or, which is the same, they give me a DA A squared plus A squared DA. So that looks like my F squared, except that my trace F squared should be trace DADA plus DAA squared plus A squared DA plus A to the fourth. So it looks like we are missing the A to the fourth, but actually the A to the fourth is there because trace A to the fourth is trace A cube A. And then I move the A through by cyclicity, but that's an odd form with an odd form, so I get a minus sign, so that's minus trace A to the fourth, okay? So trace A to the fourth just vanishes. And actually any trace A to the 2n vanishes. So that's why, well, this term is not there in F square and here. So you very explicitly see how DQ3 equals trace F squared. Except that this is defined on every coordinate patch. It's not something that is globally well defined. Okay. Let me also give you the The next example, the Chern-Simons 5 form. Q5 is trace ADA DA plus 3/2 A cubed DA plus 3/5 A to the 5. And you can again check that DQ5 is just trace F wedge F wedge F. Okay? Okay. Now, we started with the trace F to the M, which was, so this is my PM, and we have seen that this was a closed form, and obviously this was gauge invariant, because this thing just transforms to GG minus 1, which I can cycle through the trace. So we know that on a gauge transformation, these PM are invariant. Okay. Now, the same, of course, is not true for these Chern-Simons forms. Certainly, they are not closed, because we know that D of Q to M minus 1, they are just the PM locally. Okay. Now, what about the gauge variation? Well, these Chern-Simons forms, I wrote them in terms of A and DA, but you can just as well rewrite them in terms of A and F, by replacing dA by F minus A squared. But they explicitly involve the A's, so they are not gauge invariant, okay? But we can easily say something about the gauge variations of these Chern-Simons forms. Okay, so the let's consider the gauge variation of any of these Chern-Simons forms. Well, if I take the exterior derivative of the gauge variation, well, you can easily see that taking exterior derivatives and gauge variations are two operations that commute. You can do them in one or the other order. So that's the gauge variation of D of 2qm minus 1. But this is my PM, and my PM a gauge invariant. So this is zero, okay? So we find that the gauge variation of Q to M minus 1 is a closed form. Now these Chern-Simons forms, they were anyhow only defined locally on every coordinate patch, and on every coordinate patch a closed form is exact. So because they're closed, I know they must be D of some 2m minus 2 form, okay? And usually we write a 1 here to indicate that because that's a gauge variation, it must contain a gauge parameter somewhere, okay? Now later on I will replace the gauge variation by the Beerus-T transformation, in which case the gauge transformation parameter epsilon gets replaced by a ghost field. So this one actually indicates that this thing has a ghost number 1. Okay, so let me again give you the examples. So for my Chern-Simons 3 form, the Chern-Simons 3 form is here, okay? So if you compute the, well, we can rewrite this as trace AF minus a third A cube. It's easier to work out the gauge variation written this way. And you find that the gauge variation of this Chern-Simons 3 form well, you need to do a few lines of computation, but you find that this is the trace Okay. So I had my gauge variation parameter epsilon, and then I did some redefinition with some i's, and now it's called v. Okay. So you get a trace dv times dA. Okay. Well, there are two ways to rewrite this as an exact form. We may write this as d of trace v dA, because you get a dv and you would get a d square a, which vanishes. Or we can write this as minus d of trace of dv times a. Minus because d on dv gives nothing, but you go through this one form, you get a minus sign to get the dA. So first of all, you see that there are many ways to obtain, to write my exact form. Many ways. So this should be my d of q to 1. And obviously, there are many ways to write it. The difference between the two is, again, difference between this thing and this thing is an exact form. So obviously q to 1 is only defined up to adding the d of some one form, okay, alpha 1 1. So there's always a certain ambiguity here in how we do this. Just as when defining the transimens forms, they were defined by saying that d of the transimens form was Pm, but of course I could also add to my transimens form some exact form that wouldn't have changed the result. Okay. Okay, and you can do the same thing for the transimens 5 form. Look at the variation of it. Find the Q41, and the Q41, at least one representative of it, is trace V d of A dA plus 1/2 A cube. Okay? Now V is more or less my epsilon, so up to some factors of I, this is trace epsilon d of A dA plus 1/2 A cubed. And if I write it out in components, that's a 4 form, so there's some epsilon nu rho sigma epsilon alpha trace of T alpha. So this term is a DADA, so this is a d mu A nu d rho A sigma. So T beta T gamma beta gamma plus these cubic terms, these order A cube terms, okay? But that's exactly our anomaly, okay? This was our anomaly under the non-abelian gauge transformations, up to some coefficient, of course. And so the goal now is to show that we didn't compute the order A cube terms, but I'll show that one can determine the order A cube terms, and I will show that it's exactly this Q41 which will give us the anomaly, okay? And you can generalize this then to arbitrary even dimensions, and the corresponding anomalies will always be given by these Q2m minus 2 one forms. Okay? So this thing here, this Q21, which is a trace V dA, would be, or which upon replacing V by my epsilon, trace epsilon dA would be the corresponding gauge anomaly in 2 space-time dimensions. Okay? This was in 4, this is in 2. Okay, so no, actually, let me get back here. Okay. So, in general, we have these relations. We have the p's, which are 2m forms. Then we define this way these transiemens forms that are 2m minus 1 forms, and then by looking at the gauge variations of my transiemens form to be d of some q 2m minus 2 forms, we get this 2m minus 2 forms. So we sort of walk around between forms of different degrees, 2m, 2m minus 1, 2m minus 2. So we go to lower forms, and this is called descent. Okay, so these are called the descent equations. Now, obviously you should be aware that, as I said, there's a certain ambiguity. So the Q2m minus 1 forms are only defined up to adding some exterior derivative of some gamma, some 2m minus 2 form. Because they're only defined by saying that d of it should be pm, but d of this will drop out. Okay? So then, in the next step, when we determine this q2m minus 2 forms, again, the q2m minus 2 1 form, again, I can always add d of something. So they necessarily are only defined up to adding the d of some 2m minus 3 form. Okay? But because of this ambiguity here, when I take the gauge variation of my Q, I get the gauge variation of this term, which is already d of something. So that translates into another possibility to add the gauge variation of this gamma 2m minus 2 form. Okay, so these Q2m minus 2 forms are defined only by an equivalence up to adding an exact form or the gauge variation of something else. Now, I just told you that they will correspond to our anomaly. And this indetermination here is, of course, exactly what we expect for the anomaly, because if this is the anomaly, or sort of the density, because the anomaly was the expression where we integrated this, okay? When we integrate this, this goes away. So the integrand is always defined up to an exact form. But the integral of this is the gauge variation of some local functional. And I insisted very much that my anomaly was only defined up to adding the gauge variation of some local functional, because we could always add some quote-unquote counter term to our action, and if we could cancel the anomaly by this, then the anomaly was irrelevant. So there's always the freedom to add such counter terms, and that's exactly what's translated here. Okay. Now, we said that the anomaly was relevant if we couldn't cancel it by such addition of a local counter term, and we now have a nice way to characterize whether the anomaly is relevant or not, because all these inequivalent forms of my Q2m minus 2, they all correspond to the same invariant polynomial. Okay, so you compute some anomaly, which is some 2m minus 2 form, and you do the inverse of these descent equations, and you get some invariant polynomial which characterizes invariantly the anomaly. And if this is non-vanishing, then you have a relevant anomaly. Okay. Well, this was all math, if you wish. Now let's go back to physics. But of course, we'll use all of this. So let me discuss the Wess-Zomino consistency condition, which constrains the form of our anomaly. Okay, and the goal is to see that the Wess-Zomino consistency condition constrains our anomaly in exactly such a way that the solution to these consistency conditions is given by this Q41 or more generally by this Q2M minus 21 in arbitrary dimensions. So, Vesemino condition. Okay, so, well, eventually we want to look at arbitrary even dimensions, but for the moment let's keep on with what we had in four dimensions. Okay? Now, when we discuss the anomaly, we look at some gauge variation of, our effective action. So there's some parameter epsilon alpha of x, which characterizes my gauge variation. Okay? And we had done our previous discussion just in flat Minkowski space. So in flat Minkowski space, there was no issue of coordinate patches or transition functions. Now, we may redo the same discussion on an arbitrary manifold where we need several coordinate patches, but we can always assume that for we look at gauge transformations such that the epsilons are non-zero only on a single coordinate patch. Okay. If we are on flat Minkowski space, we will assume that at infinity they drop to zero. Okay, that's something we implicitly did assume. So, if they are non-zero only on a single coordinate patch and at the boundary they vanish, in particular, then I can always integrate by parts, or the integral of any closed, of any exact thing, okay, will always be zero. So now formally, I don't have to worry about patching together the things on various coordinate patches. Okay, that's what you always do when you do physics. Okay, so what's the Vesemino consistency condition? Well, our anomaly was defined as the gauge variation of some effective action, okay, W, or maybe now usually I write gamma, but I mean the same thing. There's some effective action, and the gauge variation of this effective action is my anomaly. Okay, so the gauge variation of an arbitrary functional, we have discussed this. So this is the integral d4x, the delta gamma by delta A times the gauge variation of A, which is d mu epsilon delta gamma by delta A mu. Okay? And we can integrate this thing by parts. So this was minus integral d4x epsilon alpha of x d mu delta gamma by delta A mu of x component alpha. Okay. So we identify then the anomaly with this thing. Okay, so the anomaly was minus d mu delta by delta A mu of x component alpha acting on gamma of A. We had seen this, and we had interpreted this as the covariant derivative of the current. Vacuum expectation value of the quantum current in the presence of A. Now let's have a different reading of the same equation. This is some functional differential operator. Okay? So what this states is that the anomaly is some functional derivative of something. Okay. So the anomaly depends on x and alpha, and this is some functional derivative that depends on x and alpha acting on some functional. Well, morally, this is the same as when you say you have some vector field Vi, which is a d by dxi of something. And you know that if you have a gradient like this, the gradient is constrained. So if then you compute the curl of this thing, for example, that's zero, right? Or it's just like saying when if you have a one form, psi one, which is d of a zero form, then you know that d of psi one is zero. An exact form is closed. So there's some similar constraint here, which will tell me that if I use this differential operator again and I act on the anomaly, I will find, if I do it correctly, I will find zero. Okay? So this is the Vesomino consistency condition. So we define a differential, a functional differential operator to be exactly this thing here, minus d mu delta by delta a mu of x component alpha. Okay? And then we can say that the anomaly is g alpha of x acting on gamma of a. Okay. Now, as a functional differential operator, you may just compute, for example, what's the commutator of two such operators. So g alpha of x commutator with g beta of y. Well, it's a computation of a couple of lines. You have functional derivatives, so you get some deltas, and to be sure, and you get derivatives of delta functions, so to be sure not to do anything stupid, you should multiply with some test function, integrate. It's not complicated. You find that these g satisfy an algebra. So this equals delta 4 of x minus y, the structure constants of my Lie group, C alpha beta gamma, G gamma of X. Okay? Well, you can multiply this with I squared, so an I, and an I. And you could say that these I times G alpha, they satisfy some sort of local version of the Lie algebra, right? If you didn't have the delta here, it would just be the same algebra as the Lie algebra generators. So that's something like the corresponding loop algebra or so. Okay. Just like when you do Kac-Moody, you have a Lie algebra, you have a corresponding loop algebra, which is Kac-Moody algebra. So this is in four dimensions now. So they satisfy this algebra. Well, I may now take this identity and apply this on my gamma. Well, if you apply this on gamma, you get, let's forget the eyes now, I don't need the eyes here. Okay, so what I find is that g alpha of x, g beta on gamma, which is the anomaly, which is a beta of y, minus g beta of y, a alpha of x, equals delta 4 of x minus y, c alpha beta gamma, a gamma of x. So that's some condition my anomaly must satisfy. And that's called the Vesomino consistency condition. Okay? There's no... Okay. Well, so this is some sort of... It's a set of functional differential equations. So they obviously will constrain the form of my anomaly. If you think of this as a differential equation for A, it's a linear differential equation. So as any linear differential equation, if you have a solution, you can multiply it with some number, you still have a solution. So this will not determine the normalization of the anomaly, but it will determine, it will constrain the form, the functional form of my anomaly. Okay? So, that's what I said. We computed the term, we computed that our anomaly had this form, and from our Feynman diagram computation, we got the coefficient in front of it. But we didn't get the cubic terms, okay? So we will use this Vesomino consistency condition to determine that the cubic terms are this. That's this equation will tell us. But of course, it doesn't tell us the coefficient, but we know already what is the coefficient because we did this triangle computation, okay? So then we will have the complete form of this anomaly in four dimensions, and it's the same game in any even dimension. Okay, so we need to solve this consistency condition now. So to solve it, we want to reformulate it in a slightly different way. So far I've been talking about gauge variations of my effective action, but as you know, we may just as well rephrase this in terms of a BRST transformation. So let me remind you first, what is the BRST transformation? So there's some BRST operator, which usually is called S, and this BRST transformation is defined to act on the gauge fields and on the matter fields exactly as would do a gauge transformation, except that we replace the parameter epsilon by the ghost field. Okay, so S on A mu alpha. So this was, what was it? It was d mu epsilon alpha plus c alpha beta gamma a mu beta epsilon gamma. So now we replace the epsilon by the ghost field omega. Okay, so that's the BRST transformation of my gauge field. Well, we were used to writing this in a more compact form, finding A alpha T alpha. So we wrote this just in terms of A mu. So this was D mu epsilon minus I commutate of A mu with epsilon. So now epsilon becomes the ghost. So omega stands for omega alpha T alpha, just as we did before, okay? And if instead of A mu, we deal with the corresponding differential, A, we'll have SA equals D omega minus I A with omega, something like this, okay? Okay. Now there's a little, this BRST transformation, because it involves the ghost, which is something that anti-commutes, we will have to decide how the ghosts and my differentials, whether they should commute or anti-commute. Of course, these are different objects, so it's like when you ask what happens if you exchange two identical particles that are fermions, you know you get a minus sign. But what happens if you exchange two fermions that are not identical, an electron and a proton, and you decided at some point you also wanted to get a minus sign? Okay, that's something you decided arbitrarily, but that simplifies everything. So exchange of two fermions gives a minus sign. Similarly, decide that this is minus dx mu omega. So this thing actually here will turn out to be an anti-commutator. Okay, what about the other fields? Well, on my meta fields, BRST on the meta field, this was I epsilon psi, so now this is I omega psi. On the psi bars or psi daggers, it's gonna be plus or minus I psi dagger omega. It's not omega star. Omega star is the anti-ghost, which has nothing to do, it's not the complex conjugate or the Hermitian conjugate of omega. So it's omega, not omega star here, okay? And so that just follows from the fact that we want the BST transformation to act like a gauge transformation with the gauge transformation parameter replaced by the ghost. But we also need to decide how this BST transformation acts on the ghost field itself, on the anti-ghost field. So S on omega is actually I omega omega. So what does it mean? Omega omega is omega alpha, omega beta, t beta. So that's omega alpha, omega beta, t alpha, t beta, because that's anti-symmetric. We get the half a commutator, t alpha, t beta. So this is just I over 2 C alpha beta gamma omega alpha omega beta T gamma, right? That's what is meant by I omega omega. Now on the anti-ghost, well, you see the BRST transformation always changes the ghost number by 1 unit. A and psi and psi dega have ghost number 0, but the BRST transformation produces 1 ghost field, so that's ghost number 1. Now we want to define the anti-ghost as having ghost number minus 1. So this thing should have ghost number 0. And when you introduce the BRST fields, you usually also introduce some auxiliary field, which is called H, which has ghost number 0. And then SH is 0. Okay. So these are my BRST transformations. Now, we may now redefine or rewrite the anomaly when we said that delta epsilon of gamma was the anomaly. We may just rewrite this by saying, so that's a functional of A only, that the BRST transformation of the effective action is the integral omega alpha A alpha. Okay? So we call this the anomaly, and it is a functional, it depends on the ghost and on the gauge field. Okay. So now if we ask, well, what happens if I apply again a BRST transformation on this anomaly? So A of omega and A, well, the anomaly was already S of gamma, so that's S of S gamma of A. Well, what I didn't tell you, but you certainly know, this BRST transformation, well, on the gauge and on the meta field, it was just defined to be like a gauge transformation, but then this choice, how it acts on the ghost itself, was dictated by the fact that we wanted to construct a nilpotent operation. We wanted that S squares to 0. You do it twice, you get 0. Okay? And you can check, of course, with these definitions here, that if you do S twice, you get 0. Okay? So S times S on gamma necessarily is 0. Okay? So this is a constraint on the form of this anomaly. And of course, it must be the same as the Vesomino consistency condition. Okay? It's easy to show. That's easy to show that that's just the same as the Vesomino consistency condition. So what's S on A of omega and A? Well, that's S on the integral omega alpha A alpha. So it's, we get an S on omega, that's S omega times A alpha, and then we get a minus, as this goes through the ghost, it's, we get a minus omega alpha S of A alpha. Okay? Well, how does S act on A alpha? A alpha depends only on the gauge field. So just acts as a gauge transformation with parameter omega. But the gauge transformation is done by this G operator that I defined before, right? This G alpha d mu delta by delta A mu component alpha. That's exactly how we do a gauge transformation on any functional. That's how we define them. So this is omega beta G beta acting on A alpha. Okay? Now S omega alpha, I've written it somewhere. This is, well, S omega is this. So if you write it out in components, this is some C alpha, beta gamma, omega beta, omega gamma. Okay? So both terms have omega omega. So this now is integral omega alpha omega beta. You need to reshuffle the indices here. And you have a, that's a half, I guess, okay. So you have a 1/2 C alpha beta gamma, A gamma, and here, because alpha and beta, no, you don't get a half here yet. Anyhow, you don't get a half, you get a half, you get a half there, you get a half here. You get a half everywhere, I guess, okay? When you anti-symmetrize here, you get plus G beta on A alpha minus G alpha on A beta, okay? So this has to vanish because S squared vanished. So you get exactly the Vesomino consistency condition, okay? So the Vesomino consistency condition can be written very consistently as by saying that the BRST transformation of this anomaly, where we replace the epsilon by the ghost, has to vanish. Okay, so that's a very compact way to write this consistency condition. And so we can use the same language because S squares to zero. We can again talk about a cohomology, and we talk about BRST cohomology. Okay, so we say that if S of F is zero, we say that F is BRST closed. Okay, if F is D of some H, we say that F is BRST exact. And then, of course, again, we are interested in the cohomology classes. So a BRST cohomology class is SF equals zero, and an equivalence, F is equivalent to F plus SH. Okay? So now the anomaly, we can say that the anomaly, yes? Oh, S, yes, yes, thank you. That's an S, of course, yeah. Thank you. Okay, so this anomaly there is now BRST closed, but we may always change the anomaly by adding the BRST transformation of some local functional F, because it corresponds to the fact that we could add some local counter term to our original effective action, and the anomaly is only defined up to addition of such counter terms. And this was the question of whether it was relevant or irrelevant. Okay, so we exactly find that the anomaly, it's BRST closed, it's defined only up to adding a BRST exact term. So we can say that the anomaly is a BRST is given by a BRST cohomology class. But of course there's one ghost, so we have to specify it's a BRST cohomology class at ghost number one. Okay. So that's exactly as with the forms and the Durham cohomology. we are talking about the Rahm cohomology classes for forms of a certain degree. So the degree is replaced by the Gauss number here and the exterior derivative by the BRST operator. Okay, the anomaly, well, relevant, we should say relevant anomalies, because that's the whole point, that we could add a local term. Okay, so now let's use this to figure out our cubic terms in A. Well, we could make a break now, but actually what I think what we should do is not have a short break now, a long break and a short break, but like have go through the whole morning and have two breaks somehow in between. Does it sound good? So we make a break like in half an hour and then go on for another hour and a half or so, and then, or is there any constraint that we should make the break at no, okay. Okay, so our anomaly, we have done our Feynman diagram computation and we know the terms that are quadratic in A. Okay, so if I write them now with the new normalization with the i's and all this stuff, it's at I over 24 pi square integral trace my Gauss field omega dA dA. So this is the part quadratic in A which we did compute from our triangle diagram, okay? And what we did not compute are the higher order terms, okay? So the higher order terms, well, they always come with a Gauss field, which was the epsilon, but I may add many higher order terms. So the cubic terms, it has to be some differential form. We know this because the anomaly was related to the gamma 5, so it was the epsilon mu nu rho sigma term. I can always write this as a differential form. So the higher order terms, there is a b1 a squared dA, there is a b2 a dA a, there's a b3 dA a square, and then I can have a term c a to the fourth, okay? So these are all the possible four forms I can write. They must all have the same sort of scaling dimension, of course. So these are, gauge field is dimension one, a derivative is dimension one, they are all dimension four objects, okay? And so then we try to figure out what's B1, B2, B3, and C, okay? So first you show that, so you compute S of A, and you want to show that it's zero, okay? So, well, of course, you can get all sorts of cancellations between the different terms, the S of the different terms. But, for example, you can easily show that S of trace of omega A to the fourth, like for the last term, gives rise to various terms, but there will be a term which is trace omega squared A to the fourth, which we get from the BRST transformation of the Gauss field, plus terms that involve omega and a d omega term, d omega. Okay. Now, these terms, which are an a to the 4, you can't get from any of the others because they always involve at least a derivative of a, which either gives a dA or a d omega, okay? So those terms cannot be cancelled by any of the other, and you easily conclude that C has to be zero, okay? So yeah, then you need to figure out the B's. Now, of course, so then you compute S of the rest of the bracket. It doesn't have to vanish. It only needs to add up to some exact form. If this adds up to D of something, because you integrate it, it's just as good, okay? So you need to compute S of the other terms and show that they must add up to some exact form. And that determines all the B1, B2, B3. Now, if we had plenty of time, I would do the computation, but we don't have plenty of time. So you find that this is a half, this is minus a half, and that's a half, okay? So a half minus half plus a half. So these three terms then add up to be D of A cube. Okay? So I can just erase these three terms. This wasn't there. So that's plus a half D of A cube. Okay? Now DADA, I may just as well write as D of ADA, because you get the DA and then the D square is zero. So what we find then, that's an I over 24 pi square trace omega D of ADA plus a half A cubed. Okay. Well, this thing is exactly, I've erased it, but that's exactly our Q41, where now the 1 stands for 1 ghost field. Okay, that's exactly what we got from by descent from our Chern-Simons 5 form. Okay, so you have a little bit situation which is slightly strange. So in D equals 4, we find that the anomaly is given. Well, there's some prefactor which we computed by doing our Feynman diagram. And then it's the integral of Q41. This 4 form, which you get by descent from the variation of the Chern-Simons 5 form. And this Chern-Simons 5 form was related to trace F. But of course, in 4 dimensions, there are no 5 forms and there are no 6 forms. Okay? So this is a formal construction which allows you to define these Q41 by descent from some invariant polynomial made from a 6 form in 6 dimensions. But your true spacetime is only 4-dimensional. So you should actually imagine somehow that you get to this through some auxiliary construction where we changed somehow our spacetime by adding 2 more dimensions. Well, if you are in string theory and string compactification and Kaluza-Klein and so on, you will not be shocked by this. So somehow we have our 4-dimensional space-time and we have to add some 2-dimensional space somehow. Maybe some 2-sphere or something like this to formally have some 6-dimensional manifold on which we can define such 6 forms. And then we can do our descent equations to get to the Q41. And we have just shown by, well, not by trial and error, but by imposing this Vesomino consistency condition, we have determined all the coefficients and we have found that, wow, it's the Q41 which appears for the anomaly, okay? Now, of course, there's a good reason, and we have argued in general that the anomaly should be given by a Beerus T cohomology class of ghost number 1. Okay? So you can show that if you have some auxiliary spacetime like this, more dimensions. So we start actually by some d equals 2r dimensional manifold, and we construct the auxiliary 2r plus 2 dimensional manifold. Okay. So on this 2r plus 1 dimensional manifold, I can make my characteristic classes pr plus 1, which are these traces of f, which f r plus 1 times. And I can do my descent equations from there to some q 2r plus 1, the Chern-Simons form, and then to the q 2r 1. And the claim is that the integral, so now the 1 means there's one ghost field, okay? So now the descent equations are pr plus 1 equals d of q 2r plus 1, and s, not the gauge, but the VRST variation of q 2r plus 1 is d of q 2r 1, okay? And the claim is that the integral of q 2r 1 over m 2r is a representative of the BRST cohomology at ghost number 1. So it solves the consistency conditions, okay? The claim is that S of this is 0, and integral q 2r 1 is not S of something, okay? That's the claim. And, well, let me see whether I can show this without too much difficulty. Well, let me show it partly, not completely. So once you've shown this, it's a representative of the BRST cohomology at ghost number 1. You've shown that it solves the Vesumino consistency conditions, okay? And as such, it's a good candidate for the anomaly. Okay, let's see. So you have this q 2r plus 1, the Chern-Simons form. If I make S of it, and another S, that's 0, because S is nilpotent, okay? But S of Q of the Chern-Simons form is D of my Q2R. So this is S of D of Q2R1, okay? Now S and D are commute, or rather anti-commute, so this is minus D of S Q2R1. Okay, so that shows that this S of Q2R1 is closed, okay? So this is closed, because D of it is 0, okay? Now, again, for this issue of anomaly, we consider that our ghost field falls off to 0 outside of any given coordinate patch, so a closed form is exact, so then S Q2R1 is D of some 2R minus 1 form with two ghosts now. Ghost number would be 2. Okay. And then if I integrate this, I find that S of the integral of Q2R1 is the integral of D of my alpha 2R minus 1 2, which is 0. So I've shown that this thing is BRST closed. Okay, so it satisfies the Vesumino consistency condition. What I still need to show is that it's not BRST closed just because it's BRST exact. Okay, so I must show that the integral of Q2R1 is not S of something. Okay. Well, that's slightly more tricky. It's not that complicated. So you first you assume this, and then show you to get to a contradiction. Okay. So let me not go into this detail. You can show this. So then you've shown that this thing solves the Vesemino consistency condition. You cannot write it just as a BST variation of something else. So in this sense, it's a good candidate for a relevant anomaly. Okay. Now, that doesn't completely show yet that the anomaly has to be this thing, because you may have several non-trivial BST cohomologies at Gauss number one, and only one of them is the anomaly. Okay. But we have seen, of course, in four dimensions, that the DADA term is exactly what we get from the Feynman diagram computation. So this must be the right thing. And you can similarly, like when we constrain the coefficients there, show that there's only one such solution to the BST cohomology condition. So this thing must be the relevant form of the anomaly up to some coefficient. Okay. And this coefficient, there's no way to get it from the Vesemino consistency condition because it's a linear condition. So you have to do at least one computation to determine this coefficient. Now, we did a Feynman diagram computation. And similarly, in two R dimensions, you can compute the R plus 1 point function, as we discussed, to get this coefficient there. So in 10 dimensions, you have to compute the hexagon, for example. Okay. Now, that's a lot of work, and people thought there might be something, some other way to get to this result, and that's what I will discuss soon. But before this, let me make some remarks. Okay, and then we make the break. Okay, two remarks. Remark number one. So this Q2R, which is my anomaly, but I can add to it some exact form and gauge variation. This thing is uniquely characterized by the descent equations in terms of my PR plus 1, which is this trace F wedge F R times. Okay. The anomaly is this thing times this coefficient. Okay. So it makes sense to say that the anomaly is characterized by C times this invariant polynomial, and the value of C, of course, was determined by the fact that I did my computation with a spin 1/2 fermion, chiral fermion running around this loop. Okay. Now, these Qs or these things involve these traces. And they are the generators, okay? So this trace in particular involves my D alpha beta, well, alpha 1 up to alpha r plus 1 if I'm in 2r dimensions. So this gives me the D symbol, and this thing is completely symmetric, so that's where the D symbol comes from, okay? Now, if I have several fields, they add up to the anomaly with the corresponding C coefficients, okay? So if I have many fields, if I have a set of fields psi I in my theory, so that's some set, how shall I write it? Okay, that's some set of fields S. So every psi I has a corresponding C I, and my anomaly then is the sum over all these i's, or over all the fields psi I in my set S of the coefficients ci, q2, r1. Okay? But I may just as well characterize this by the corresponding polynomial. Okay, so by descent, that's related to the sum over all the fields in the set of my fields of this ci times the pr plus 1. Okay? So it makes sense to sort of sum all this, and we call this the total anomaly polynomial, which is a 2r plus 2 form. Okay. So if I have several fields, my total anomaly is characterized by this thing here. Now that's very convenient to study the cancellation of anomalies, because at this level, of course, we always wrote the same thing, but we know there's a certain ambiguity here. We could add exact form, BOST exact things, but at the level of the p's, there's no freedom. All the different manifestations of the anomaly are given by the same invariant polynomial. So once we add them up with the corresponding coefficients, the question then is, if this is zero, the total anomaly cancels, and if it's non-zero, there is a remaining anomaly, and there's no way to cancel it by whatever countersums we could add. Okay? So that's one remark. The second remark is that this invariant polynomial, which characterizes my anomaly, it's something we have seen before. Right? We have seen actually for the abelian anomaly, which was sort of a different case, we had seen that the anomaly was related to the integral of epsilon mu nu rho sigma f mu nu f rho sigma, so this, which is the integral of the trace of f wedge f. And for the abelian anomaly, we had done this computation by doing the trace of the gamma 5, which we had to regulate, and we had shown that this was related to the index of my Dirac operator. Okay. But it was just the Dirac operator in four dimensions, on my four-dimensional space-time. Okay. That's for the abelian anomaly. Now we look at the non-abelian, or the anomaly under gauge transformations. Okay. So for the gauge anomaly, we find now that our anomaly is characterized again by some trace f wedge f cross wedge f, but in three dimensions it's characterized, in four dimensions it's characterized by some six form trace f wedge f wedge f, or more generally by our pr plus 1, which is a 2r plus 2 form, so a d plus 2 form. Okay. Well, the index theorem is true in any even dimension, and so this invariant polynomial is again related, of course, by the index theorem to the index of some Dirac operator, but this Dirac operator now acts on some d plus two-dimensional manifold. Well, that's what I said. We have to construct some auxiliary d plus two-dimensional manifold, and it appears that my anomaly is characterized by this trace f wedge f wedge f, which you know is related by the index theorem to an index of some Dirac operator on a manifold of two dimensions more. Okay? So people have thought, of course, that this could not be a coincidence, and they have actually managed to compute the anomaly in a different way, and related indeed to the index of some d plus two-dimensional Dirac operator. Okay. Now the index is just a, well, you have to figure out what exactly is this Dirac operator, because you start with a d-dimensional Dirac operator, so you have to add two more the terms corresponding to the two extra dimensions. But this can be done, and you can compute this index. And when you compute this index, you find, of course, that this index is related to this trace f to the r plus 1, and you get a very precise coefficient here. Okay? And this coefficient gives you then this coefficient c of your anomaly without having to do a Feynman diagram computation. Okay? And, of course, you check that in four dimensions you get the same result as you got from the Feynman diagram computation. And this check, I mean, the check is very important because, you know, I always think you can do many nice and formal arguments, but you're never really 100% sure whether it's really true. But once you check it against some Feynman diagram computation, which you know how to do, then if it coincides, then sort of you trust in this more formal developments. So I think now we make a break till 15 minutes, and then we start sort of a quarter to 11.